Thanks so much, Katie, for joining us.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah. So one thing that's pretty well documented about you is how you got your big break. You went on Jools Holland, and you were a fill-in for Nas.
I was. I know. Apparently, Nas's father was playing trumpet on the track that he was due to play, and his father had flu or something. So thank you to Nas's dad.
It seems like you were kind of this overnight success, but in actuality, you were toiling for many years.
It did feel like an overnight success because there hadn't been any success up until that point. But, you know, I had spent a long time, like the best part of 10 years, with my parents just going, get a job. You know, they never listened to music, so they had no idea if I was any good.
Well, what were the kinds of gigs that you were playing up until that point?
I did actually literally play to three men and a dog once. It was in Putney in London, in South London, and three guys and a dog turned up.
Oh my God.
And they liked it. Yeah. And I think that was what was really, that's kind of what kept me going. That, I mean, I was playing to empty rooms for a bit, but even if there's only two people there, one of them would come up and say, I really love what you're doing.
Well, I find it really interesting that you chose this path because from what I've heard, music wasn't a big part of your childhood.
I didn't get to music through listening to my parents' record collection because it was pretty much non-existent.
Mm-hmm. And why was that?
They were both academics. I mean, not to say that academics don't listen to music, but my father's a physicist, my mum a school teacher, and they just did, it wasn't their thing. They met as mountaineers. They spent as much time as they could outside with no PowerPoints. But yeah, it was just a compulsion to play instruments. So at four, I was asked, Mum, I want a piano.
The first time that I heard your music was in the opening sequence of the film The Devil Wears Prada, Suddenly I See was playing. But I thought it was so cool when I found out that the song was actually this tribute to Patti Smith.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, I thought it was funny because when I saw the sequence, I was like, oh my God, that looks like I wrote the lyrics for that.
Exactly.
For
that scene.
Well,
that's what I was going to say.
It was a huge, huge deal for me, and I just have this really funny experience now where pretty much anyone I meet who says, you know, what do you do? I say, I'm a musician, and what's your music like? And I've now, instead of trying to describe it, I'll just say, have you seen Devil Wears Prada? They're like, yeah, and I go, well, that's my song at the beginning. You know, ultimately, the song is really meaningful to me.
Yeah.
About what I was saying, that I was inspired by this incredibly powerful woman.
Yes.
And her presence and her ability and her talent and her rawness and honesty. It's important for me to hold on to what the song means.
Right.
But the really magical thing about something like that happening is that you get so many people to your gig. I heard your song on the film, I bought your album, I discovered what it meant, I've discovered all your other stuff. And so really, I just see these as skeleton keys that can make other stuff happen.
Well, it must have been amazing to have such a huge hit that affected so many people.
Yeah.
But I would think it would also be somewhat of a double-edged sword because it's like once you have one huge hit like that, it's like you want more.
You go into being a musician because you like singing and you like playing and you write and there's a compulsion to play for people. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I suddenly found myself employing 15 people.
Right.
Being responsible for a band that have worked for me for 6 or 7 years. Mm-hmm. And because of that hit, getting used to people buying tickets to the shows and selling out.
Right.
And now we're in a time where everybody is having a hard time. Records aren't selling because of pirate downloading. Mm-hmm. People haven't got a lot of money in their pockets because of the recession. So gig tickets and buying albums is one of the first things that people will kind of cut down on. And then I'm just thinking, it'd be great to have another hit. But in the end, I cannot sit down and calculate how to write something.
Right.
I just have to deliver what turns me on and what excites me.
A couple of years ago, your label told you to, quote unquote, get lost.
Yeah.
Go out into the world. Yeah. What was that all about?
Well, it had been full back-to-back touring, back-to-back albums. I really hadn't taken any sort of break. Mm-hmm. And it was so successful that I think there is an element where it's quite easy to kind of over-milk the cow, you know, and milk it dry to the point where people are like, get out of my face. You're just here all the time. Mm-hmm. And I think that my label boss was really aware of that and just said, I don't want you to be in that situation where people have just had enough and they want something else. And apart from that, I don't write when I'm on tour, and that's all I'd been doing. So I really needed to take a sabbatical to concentrate on being a writer. I mean, that's kind of partly why I called the album Tiger Suit. It's about this sort of magical armor that you wear to be who you want to be when you're on stage, but also the importance of stripping that off to write, to be able to dig deep and know that no one was watching, know that you're not being judged, and be as honest as possible.
Was it scary at all taking that time off?
Really scary at times, yeah. There was a couple of months where my confidence was very low. And I have to say that I think that whatever happened during that process has made me a little more vulnerable to confidence dips.
Was there also any fear of being kind of off the radar as well?
Yeah. I was worried about that, because even in my career, which is, you know, relatively short so far, there's such a passion for anything new.
Yes.
You know, it's got to be new. And if you're new, you have this kind of rocket underneath you that everybody gets very, very excited about the new thing. And, you know, with the Twitter sphere and Facebook and everything, you're seeing people just going, suddenly I see it's an oldie but a goodie. I'm like, what? Is it an old song? But then you think, yeah, it's been 5 years. And when I brought that first album out, there was no Gaga. Mm-hmm. YouTube wasn't as, you know, it was a new thing. It wasn't that huge. The MySpace thing blew up after that record had come out. And the MySpace thing, you know, has almost been overtaken by other stuff now. I mean, it's so fast. I can't control that. I can't spend time wondering whether I was only popular because I was new. And I don't really believe that. I developed such a great relationship with a fan base that were into what I was doing. And mm-hmm. and it's cool. The same people are coming back and coming to the shows. And,
yeah.
You know, I couldn't have done a better thing, I don't think, than taking that time.